This is the Hello Video Podcast. My name is Reza. We're making video podcasts with people from all around the world because we are really curious about different countries, customs, traditions, and so on. Recently, I've decided to create a new playlist, which is called Hello Software Developers. I'm going to interview with software engineers all around the world. I'm going to ask them about their favorite tools, libraries, their journey, profession, and those kind of stuff. And today, we have a great guest from Denmark. Okay, what's your name?
My name is Mike Müller Nielsen. And yes, I'm a YouTuber, and I'm also a contractor. So I'm actually a programmer. So yeah, Java and Spring Boot is my favorite topics and main areas.
Oh, yes, very interesting. Where are you originally from?
I'm originally from a small town called Kolding, and then now I moved to Copenhagen. So yeah, it's a very pretty city, both Kolding and also Copenhagen. There's a lot of things happening there. If you haven't seen Copenhagen, come and visit. It's very beautiful.
Yes, very interesting. To be honest, I really love Norse mythology, but we are not going to talk about that. Denmark is really a great country. Okay, as a first question, how many years ago you write your first Hello World program?
That is, I'm 43 now. I can reveal that, but I was so lucky that my dad, he actually had a job within IT, but of course it was something totally different at that point. But I actually wrote something with him when I was like 7 years old or 8 years old. That was in BASIC with a Commodore 64. And we made, I think it was a wagon we made to drive from left to right or something like that. So it's many years ago. On my own, I would say like 20 years ago, 23 years ago. I started when I was 20, getting really into programming. Yeah.
Yes. And tell me about yourself, your qualification, job, profession, and those kind of stuff.
I actually started taking, first I took an education within a bachelor within a chemistry. But then there was actually not that many interesting jobs when I was when I was done. So then I got a trainee position within a company called, it was the old Bull Honeywell company. It's one of the oldest companies, at least in Denmark. And then I was so happy that I got some courses there, and I sat next to a real smart guy where I just tried to suck as much knowledge from him as possible. And then I just took on, and then like 10 years later, then I started my own small business where I set out my own hours as a contractor, and it has just been very well since then. I've never missed anything to or lacked to have anything to do. So and then it's just like now it's like a hobby also. So it's both my hobby and also my profession. So so 2 years ago, then I started this YouTube channel where I discuss. I have 2,000 subscribers right now, and I discuss tech, and then I make tutorials within Spring Boot and Python and all kinds of languages. And then it's a very good community. They usually meet up at my Discord server afterwards, and then we can talk. Then we continue to talk about technology. Yeah. So I really like programming and technology and all kind of gadgets. I really like. I'm a gadget freak. I have Google Home, of course, and Hue light, so I can just turn on the light by saying that the light should be turned off and stuff like that. So So technology and gadgets. Right. That's me.
What kind of content you usually make in your YouTube channel?
I post something every 3 days, and then it's just, then it can be, for instance, then it could be the last video I made was with Google Actions, how to make Google Assistant program that can where you can actually make a trivia, and or also where you can use webhooks with a Spring Boot backend. So it's I have the most knowledge about backends and Spring Boot and Java, but I've also I also try to get out of my comfort zone and also try to create clients. I've also developed some mobile apps for some telecom companies. But actually, it's on request. There's a lot of requests in the comments. In the beginning, I had to come up with my own ideas, but now I can actually just go read the comments. There's always some requests either on the Discord channel, on Discord server, or on the, in the comments on my YouTube channel. Then I can just take some of the good ideas that I find interesting myself, because it is a hobby. I'm not making any money of it. I have turned on ads, but it's like 400 Danish crowns per month or something like that. So it's nothing that I can live off. But it's a very fun hobby to have, and I meet a lot of nice people. Also like you, Risa. I thought it was a fun challenge that you came with here. I didn't know you, but then I went into and saw your channel, and I actually liked the idea that you can actually get a kind of a small window into other places on in the world, right? Because I think everybody actually thinks at some point, how would it be to live in some country, right? So I think your idea is really, really good, and I will also mention you on my channel.
It's really nice of you to say that. Thank you so much. You are a Java developer, and I think Java is somehow an ancient programming language like C++, like C. It's not like today's programming language like Python and JavaScript. What should you think about that? You're also a backend engineer. If you heard of about today's news, Python and also JavaScript are most famous than the Java and C++. What should you think about that? Why you love and like Java?
Python, yeah, it's just storming ahead. Its popularity has been rising year by year by year. And just like 5-10 years ago, we could always see that the Java, especially in the Nordic countries, were the favorite language, and that was a primary language. But we can actually see now that Python is so popular, because it actually makes more sense than some of the other development programming languages. It's very difficult to learn Java. It's also very difficult to learn .NET, I think. I think .NET and Java, they're kind of the same. And But most jobs in Denmark, they circle around Java still, and also .NET. So Java will definitely not disappear, because it has a benefit of it runs within the Java virtual machine, so it can run on everything, Raspberry Pis. It can run on any operating system. So Java is here to stay, and they also, I think, they saw the competition from some of the newer languages, and that's also why they have started to update their language every half year. It's instead of waiting like 2-3 years where nothing happened within Java. There was also a lot of movement in the Kotlin community, because Java was kind of static, and then Kotlin came with this fresh new language that just makes sense, just like Python does, and it has a lot of the same features as Python also have, and it has all the features that is just tedious to write in Java. So I believe that Java is here to stay, also because there are so many systems based on it, especially especially within the government. All the government systems, they are, most of them are written in Java, the tax system. So there is so much legacy, and it's also not a bad program. It's actually very stable. It's a very stable programming, and that's a good thing about it. It only updates every half a year with new stuff. So that means that there's a lot of resources to take from. There's a lot of developers to take from. It's much easier to get a Java developer than maybe a Flutter developer, just to mention something. So in Denmark, that it's .NET and Java. Those are the two main programming languages when looking for a job. Opportunities.
Keep going. I'm all ears.
I really like Python. It's much easier to teach Python. If you want to teach someone that has not seen a programming language before, teach them Python instead of Java, because the first thing you start with is this public static void main. Okay, why do we write public? Why do we write static? We have to just explain a lot of weird stuff before we can actually come to the code. While in Python, you just start writing your print statement on one line, and then you can run the Python file as a script. And that's what we that's what we do. That's what we need with Java also. We got a little bit of it when we got the Java console where we can write, where we can actually write Java scripts. Yeah, it's not JavaScript, but it's Java code, but in a command line where you just write one line at a time, and then it will actually be compiled and run. So we got this some years ago, but it's in Python, it's just more, it's just much easier to get to. It makes more sense for beginners. So there's a lot of object-oriented stuff in Java that is actually, it's almost never used. Like, now I say something that I might get in trouble for, but like interfaces, it's the fewest people actually write their own interfaces. And if they do, they didn't have to write those interfaces, for instance. So there's a lot of object-oriented, way of thinking that was maybe was smart many years ago. And I think that the developers from C++, they took all the experience from C++ and also some other development language, and then they tried to make this new programming language that should just be able to do anything, and it should be object oriented. It should have a garbage collector so it could automatically clean up all the objects in the old days. And then they did not know what should we call this this new language. And then they were sitting and drinking Java coffee into the middle of the night, and then they named it Java. So it has there's a lot of legacy around Java, and it was also I think it was also mathematicians, and they were very deep with the theory, the inventors of the Java language. So
I really like Java because it's somehow a compilable language like C++. How do you think about that? Do you think it's a positive feature in Java? Compilable. What do you think about that?
Yes, definitely. I think it's very strong that it's compilable. Also, because we want to fail as fast as possible, because then that's how we move ahead. And when you make when you compile something, then of course it is checked. Of course, Python is also checked before you actually run the code, but you can actually the compilation actually gives some safety. Also, that when it's compiled to the bytecode to the .class files, then you know it's going to run on all the operating systems that you want it to run on, because the Java virtual machine is just created per operating system. So there's very few surprises you will get by running it on a different operating system. And the new cool stuff is Gradle and Docker, which just makes it so easy for us to put some of the stuff into production. We can just, and also the build pack, the build pack dependency, we can just write build pack, and then we actually build image, then we get the image, and then we can actually distribute to our production system, and we know it's going to behave exactly as it is going to behave on our local machine. So Docker plus Java plus Gradle, I think it's really, really strong, and a lot of things has made life easier for us as developers. The delivery pipeline or deployment pipeline is much easier today than it was like 10 years ago or 15 years ago. It was a hell of a time.
You are a backend engineer. Tell me about your favorite tools, libraries, and tool chains.
Spring Boot is definitely one of my favorite tool chains because it's modular, so I can just tick off if I want to connect to Azure or Amazon S3 bucket or a Mongo database or RabbitMQ, then I just tick off those modules, and then it actually almost works out of the box. So then I can just go, I can just Google, and then I can read like half a page of code, and then I can actually connect to this this new system. So I definitely favor Spring Boot. I think it's awesome. And regarding databases, I like the NoSQL databases. They're much easier to program to. And most of the time, 90% of the time, we actually do not need those relational databases and the things that they give us. And NoSQL databases are much more scalable. Facebook, for instance, is a NoSQL database. It would never have been able to make that a relational database. Yeah. So yes. And then RabbitMQ.
How about ID? What is your super favorite ID?
That must be, in the old days I used Eclipse. Then I tried IntelliJ, and then I have I've only returned to make tutorial videos about Eclipse, and I really, really tried at some point to go back to Eclipse, but IntelliJ is just so much better. And of course, it's also a paid product if you want the ultimate part and if you want all the Spring Boot help and all that. So of course, it costs, but I definitely IntelliJ. Eclipse, it's just like it has fallen behind. In the old days, it was ahead, also ahead of NetBeans and. So definitely IntelliJ.
You're a backend engineer, and I think you should like test cases. Tell me about that. Tell me about test-driven development in your career. Do you usually harness your software modules through test-driven development?
Yeah, the test UI, the good thing about being a backend developer is that we do not need to set up a UI most of the times. We do not need to set up the UI tests, which can be quite complex actually. So we can actually use Mockito for mocking off all of our services, and then we can also use integration tests like with Spring Boot tests, and so of course JUnit 5 and Mockito, they are need to have. And then, of course, we can also sometimes I use GitHubs actually. So every time I commit some code, then it runs a GitHub where it actually runs Gradle test or Maven test before it actually before it commits my code. Then I know that I don't give my colleagues any surprises. And then we use a lot of branching out. Me and my colleagues we always branch out to a new feature, and then we set in our own feature, and then we merge at some point and make a pull request. But I've also tried to work with other in other places where we actually all developed on the same branch. That just gave us more merge work, but it actually made us more in sync with, and we could more feel what was going on especially on big projects. And it actually worked quite good. So of course, sometimes it went wrong when we developed on the same branch, but it was very rare actually, and it gave us more speed than we had with the feature branches, I think. But yeah.
Yes, very interesting. Okay, yeah. Let's talk about books. You are an experienced software engineer. If you want to suggest a book, your super favorite book, which really helps junior developers to push their level, what would your suggestion?
I think the best way to learn is actually to code themselves. So instead of sitting and writing, reading a book, I would actually look at small YouTube videos, and then just take a bit by bit. Just watch a small YouTube video for like 10, 20 minutes. Go do the same thing yourself. I think that gives you much more of it gives you much more practice. Of course, there's some of the theory that you will miss in the beginning. Then you can read up on the things that if there's something you simply don't understand, why can we extend another class, or why do we have to implement an interface and stuff like that. Then you can, of course, and you can dig into it. And I would actually just say YouTube videos. I don't think I've ever actually read a book except for when I had to take an exam. I took the Java certificate in the beginning to prove that I could code, so I could get my first job. And that's since then I've actually not read any books at all about any technology. I'm watching YouTube videos and I'm searching I'm googling, and that's Beldum has such a cool site. If you're into Java, of course go to Beldum. Then there's also something called Java Code Geeks, who I cooperate with, and I also create videos for them. They also have some good examples. So I would say go through the web and then do stuff yourself. That's where you learn. That's where you learn all of the things. And if you are regular employed from a company, then of course have them give you a course, because usually that they have actually a budget for courses. So take a course once in a while, because what you get with a course, of course you get a teacher that actually explains to you all the things, but you also get the time out of your calendar where you don't need to do maintenance or new features for the business. You actually get some time where you can sit and dig into a technical subject. So it does matter, even if you're not going to use it work-wise right now, make sure that if you have the opportunity, if you're so lucky that you're employed at some place where they have a they will actually have a budget for that. Then get some courses, as many as possible. That would be my suggestion for a new developer.
Yes, very interesting. Okay. What kind of algorithms you usually face in backend development? I'm very interested to know about that.
Algorithms, like what do you mean, like for sorting, or what do you mean with algorithm, or is it machine learning? If it's machine learning we're talking about, then Java is not good. Then you have to learn Python. Then you have to go to you have to learn about TensorFlow and Keras, and they are awesome. It's awesome frameworks for machine learning. And you can actually try, there are some very very good data sets you can always you can work on, and there's some very good tutorials by Google and on the TensorFlow webpage that you can follow. So if you're interested in machine learning, it is actually much easier to get started with than you would think. Of course, the first task you're making with this with a deep neural network, with many layers, maybe you will get a headache the first time, but you can actually see the magic very easy with Keras, because you just define your layers, and then you can actually see that. Then you can categorize images from, so you can separate cats from dogs, and you can also create your own folders on your own machine, and then they first train it with cats and dogs or whatever you want to, cars or bikes, and then you can see that how good the machine are afterwards. There's some very cool data sets out there. Also, if you're interested in the U.S. election, then they have actually gathered all of Trump's tweets, so you can actually try to see if it's Trump or not by just looking at the how he writes. And of course, it's that I'm not pro con Trump at all. It's just a neutral remark there. So, yeah.
So, okay. So, you know, you're an experienced software engineer. If you wanna suggest someone some kind of learning resources to start backend engineering, I mean like microservice architecturing, like deploying, like I don't know, everything which is needed in backend engineering, what would be your suggestion if somebody wants start learning backend engineering? How should he start off with learning resources?
Of course, now I have to mention my own YouTube channel, because that's exactly what I've placed there in one of the playlists. Then I actually have one that's called Spring Boot, and then if you just start there from the beginning, that it actually explains to you what a service is, add service, annotate if you annotate with service, if you annotate with component, and if you annotate with REST controller, what is happening and what is the Spring context and all that. So of course I would say that, but also just search, go to YouTube and then search for Spring Boot tutorial. Spring Boot tutorials, then you will actually learn. Yeah, then you will learn the basics also about backends in general, not just about Spring Boot, because the principles are the same. I've created a course for Pact and for Udemy, called Kator. That is Kotlin. They have made their own version, kind of version of Spring Boot. They're trying to do the same as Spring Boot has, but having a modular backend, and they have named this project Kator. And I've created a course within that, and the principles are totally the same there as it is with Spring Boot. But it does not have to cost anything. If you're new, and especially if the money is small, that you usually are in the beginning of the career, because you need some jobs before you can get some income. So just try to keep the expenses zero in the beginning. Yeah. YouTube has so much free content. And and search the internet. There's a lot of web pages where they're just happy to get the attention, to get the traffic. Then they're actually happy, because they might earn money off ads or something like that. So I would say keep the expense to zero in the beginning. Then when you have some, and you, it doesn't matter if you have extra money, of course, then you can take a course, which of course also has its benefits, or you can take an e-learning course also later on. But it definitely in the beginning, I would say zero expense, unless you are employed by a regular company. Of course, then they have a budget usually for that. So
Yes, thank you. Okay, let me ask another question. Tell me about agile frameworks you have used in your job and challenges, you know, challenges with product owners, with customers, with the Scrum Master, and those kind of stuff?
The challenges, they're almost always the same. In Denmark and in the northern countries, we usually run Scrum or Kanban. Those are actually the only ways to work when we talk agile. And the problem is always that the Scrum Master is viewed upon as an authority, and also the product owner. The product owner sometimes seems as being a kind of a middle tier manager or something like that, and that is one problem. So in the beginning, you need to know Scrum yourself. So then you can actually, when there's retrospective, where then you will look back at the last sprint and say what went well, what didn't go well. Then you can actually correct and tell other people what Scrum is about, like. For instance, if the product owner comes and asks you for a status update maybe every day, then you should tell them, then you can say, and maybe with the Scrum book in your hand, and say, this is not how a product owner should behave. A product owner should leave it up to the team to actually be autonomous, to be able to handle tasks themselves. And it takes the time that it takes. But that said, I actually think it works quite well. In the old days, in very old days, then we had the business to stand there every second hour. I don't know. Do we have anything to do right now? Because else, then I have two or three tasks that I would like to push in between. We don't have that anymore because we have the product owner that prioritizes the task for which and puts the task that gives the most value to the business in the top of the backlog. And I think that is quite good. Then we have the Scrum Master that needs to see that too, that the process is withheld and that everybody is running Scrum the right way. And that I think the Scrum Master should also work, actually, should also program. And I think the Scrum Master head should actually be, it should be a new person all the time, because then the Scrum Master is not seen upon as somebody with authority. And then he will also be a bit more accepted in the group, I think. If it's one of the developers that just takes turn, you will have a bit more respect for the Scrum Master role. Yeah.
Yes, very interesting. Okay, I've got a very interesting question, and it's about continuous integration. I think in web development project, it's really hard to implement. Content. Continuous delivery and continuous integration system. Am I right?
It is. It has become easier, actually.
You guys have real customers. You know, when you guys publish your website, I think it's really hard to publish and deliver continuously the stable web services. Am I right?
Yes and no. It always takes some time to set up always, but it is quite easy. I made a video with Heroku, where you can actually very easily use Buildpack and Heroku, and then you can get up and running for free with Heroku. It's not like I favor Heroku or any of the other, but I like free I like free stuff, so I like that with Heroku I can actually upload my application for free as long as it's for testing and staging environment. Of course, when you come to the production environment, then of course they want money for the services, which is fair enough. But with Heroku, it is actually very easy. You can just push your code. As soon as the code has been pushed, then Heroku will build the Spring Boot application. If you're using Buildpack in Heroku, then it will just build an image, a Docker image, and then it'll spin up a container based on that Docker image. So it is quite easy. I don't think it's not everybody who knows how easy it actually is these days. I just made a video with Google Cloud Run, which is Google's way of handling this. It is a little bit more difficult, but not much. It takes, there are a couple of files that need to be configured, and you need to go configure an application on the Google Cloud. You need to set up an application right there. And then it's also quite easy, actually. Then you just push the code, it will be built and actually deployed to this. They have some weird URLs when it's for testing. Then you can then attach your own custom domains. So you could actually make a, test.mic.dk or something like that, and then I can have a staging.mic.dk, and then I can have my mic.dk, which is a production environment, and I can hook them up to different branches also. So it is doable, but it takes effort. I understand what you mean, because sometimes then you get an, especially if you are taking a job where you're not paid by the hour, but where you're paid to finish a task, that is always very dangerous. I would not recommend that. Always try to get a task where you're paid per hour, or else the customer will also try to get extra features into the final product. But of course, if you have a kind of product, you only pay for a product. Maybe your company is only paid to deliver a product. Then it can be very tempting to skip the continuous integration and the continuous delivery pipeline. But still, I think it will save you time in the long run if you just start with setting those things up. Then you don't have to think about them afterwards. And then I know maybe you will waste a week setting them up, but then you will get the time back in the long run. Almost every time. Yes. So Google Cloud, I've been running in Heroku, so try to check those off. I'll definitely recommend that. So.
Yes, very interesting. Okay.
So there's also Jenkins. If you want to set up something up on your own machines, then use Jenkins. It's very easy to use. You can set up Jenkins, and then you can put it up on a local server, and then the business can actually see, always follow the latest pushing and there. So Jenkins is awesome. And also, that's also something called Bamboo.
Is there any high tech software companies in your countries like those FANG companies in USA?
High tech companies, we have some contracting companies that actually deliver systems to the government that are quite big now. They're called Net Company. They just grew from nothing to like they're almost they're very big right now. Or else then we have the companies that is also present in other countries like Oracle, of course. Usually the big finance institutions, they have their own IT departments, and that is usually where you can get a job. There's also a company called Nets, which is a payments provider. They also have there's also a lot of jobs there. Then there's the big insurance companies. Yeah, that we have insurance, finances, the banking industry, they take a lot of developers. And the payment industry. And then there's also utility like providing power. They also have their own huge IT departments. So that is usually where you would look for jobs. Banking, finance,
yes. How developers usually prepare themselves for their interview? They have a very hard interview in their company. I mean those high tech companies.
Actually, no. There's not like there are some places where they actually have a test, and it has also become more popular to test the employees with some kind of test. But usually, usually people just sit down and talk around the table, and then there's in Denmark, there's the first month is kind of a test month for both the employer and the employee, and then there's also they also have a 3 month. It's actually a 3 month trial. Then within those 3 months, then both the parties can actually stop the cooperation with 1 day's notice or something like that. And then usually the companies, they just take in people and then they try them for 3 months or less if they're not good. But usually the people actually know what they are supposed to know. And in a lot of situations, it's actually not it doesn't matter if you know. If you're very good at Java, if you're just a rookie at Java, because you have colleagues and you usually work in a team, and then the other team members would actually help you, and they will upgrade your qualifications by helping you solving the problems until you're actually able to solve these things. Of course, if you take a role like an architect or a tech lead or something like that, then of course you need to know your thing very deeply, right? So. Yes. But they also have tests, but it's not like, yeah, It's just as usual. It's just as normal, just to get in and sit around the table, talk about it, and then you get a 3-month trial, and then it'll kick you out if you're not good enough. But that's very rare that will happen. So, yeah.
Yes. And a final question. I don't want to hold you anymore. Tell me about average salaries. I mean, software engineer average salaries in your country.
Yes, they are very, very good in Nordic countries. I think that's the. I have not heard them being. Better than this, but we also have a high tax. We have there's a high tax percentage, you know, like so between 50% and 60%. But a regular Java developer, it is some time since I've checked, I must say that, but I would think that it would be like 30,000 Danish kroners to begin with, just to begin with. And then an experienced one could get like double that, like 60,000 kroners if you're an experienced Java developer per month. And then if you're a contractor, then you can go around like 100 euros, not unusual. Sometimes a bit less, sometimes a bit more, but at like yeah, maybe between 180 and
how about,
euros.
How about other European countries?
I think Norway is maybe paying a little bit better, but not as yeah. The Norway, Sweden, Denmark, they have a very high price for engineers. I think Germany is also pretty high. I'm not sure about this. And then there's also countries like Austria and Switzerland that I think they also have pretty high salaries. And then of course there's the US. There's insanely high high salaries there. And then there's low tax in US. So I think if people go for the maximum wage that get out in the end, then I would probably say would probably be US. But we have it. We have really good conditions here. We also have a lot of freedom. Right now there's Corona, so we just work from home, and then we use a lot of remote tools like Skype and Teams and Slack, and then we have daily meetings. But then we can just code from home. So even though I'm a contractor, then I still have a job. I'm not out of business or anything. So we are very we're very spoiled in the IT industry, I would say. We have very good conditions. There's good pension. If you're regular employed, then you get a good pension. And there's usually also a gym where you work. And some places there's actually paid exercise. Then you can go exercise in the work time. I've not been a place like that. Usually there's a good cantina where you have to pay a very cheap price for the cantina for the food there, and it's almost restaurant food. So it's we have very good conditions there, and there's fruit in the afternoon. And if you have to leave, and it's also very flexible. If you have a family and you need to leave early or go to the doctors, you just do that. You just write in the morning. Or of course it's not good if you have meetings. You should try not to have meetings on top of them. Then you just say I need to go these places here, and then I'll just maybe compensate by logging on in the evening or logging on another day maybe. So
yes, I remember another interesting question. And it's about accelerator in your country. Is there any accelerator in your country for entrepreneur? Yes. Can you say some examples?
Yes, we have that. We have something called InnoBooster, and what they look at, they actually look at employment. So they would like you that you would actually create something that can employ people. So the process there is to actually come up with a good idea, try to get a little bit running yourself to begin with, and then you can apply for InnoBooster. And sometimes you can get up to like 500,000 if they like your idea. But then there's actually a panel of like 4 or 5 people that sit, and then they evaluate your idea, they evaluate your budget. So the more work they can see you have done it in it, they're not just giving up money for free. But if you have done your homework and if you made a good budget, and if you have created a company, and they can see that there is actually a potential for creating new jobs, then you can get maybe sometimes it's just 100,000, sometimes it's 200,000, but those amounts are worth a lot for people that has a startup and just wants the basic expenses paid, so they can just, they just want to be able to live, and then they usually burn so much for the idea that they don't care about salaries for themselves. They just want, just want food and a roof over their head, right? So that's what you actually think about in the beginning when you have a startup company. But sometimes you get up to like $500,000 kronas if your idea is really, really good. So yes, we have InnoBooster.
Yes, very interesting. Okay, that was a really great conversation. I really enjoyed. Any question?
I would like. What about you, Risa? Which programming language do you prefer?
Sorry. Okay. You mean about programming language?
Yeah. Which programming language do you prefer?
Yes, to be honest, I'm a C++ software engineer. And recently I've decided to learn web development through Python as a backend language and front-end development through React, a JavaScript framework. It's really interesting because I didn't know anything about architectures. Those architectures are used in web development. They're really interesting, you know. I just developed software. I mean desktop softwares, and recently I started to learn web development. It's very interesting, and I think in the future, all of business they turf out those ancient systems. I mean like desktop systems and those kind of stuff. I think so. How do you think? Do you agree with me?
I think C++, I'm not seeing that very much anymore. But if you really like Python, I would actually recommend just to look at Flask as a background.
Yes.
Also Django, they are really, really cool backend frameworks for Python. And then if you like React, then you're going to love Vue. It's even simpler than React. And it's React is really, really good, but Vue.js is also awesome. So
you know, I think learning curve of Angular is really high, you know, but React is really easy to learn, I think. And but I don't know exactly about React and Angular, but I think they're really same, you know. I think also React is used in mobile development. Am I right? How about Angular? Angular is used for mobile applications, like React Native?
Then I don't think that Angular is I've never heard about it. It might be, but that's React. That's React Native that has been used for mobile development. And then the new cool stuff for mobile development, that is Flutter, and Flutter is it's really awesome, and it's so easy to use Flutter. So I definitely also recommend if anyone is interested in mobile development, Flutter. That's where I would start. It's multi platform. So if you write a Flutter application for one platform, then it works for all of them, iOS, Android. If Windows Phone would ever come again,
But you know, I just experienced in C++ development. But to be honest, my favorite things is refactoring through TDD because this is my responsibility in my job. I usually just one of my biggest responsibility in my work is to refactor the legacy codes and upgrading them. It was really hard, you know. What's your idea about that? I mean, about refactoring. I think web development doesn't have that much refactoring. Am I right?
Yes, and it's easier to find developers that actually knows, even though it's an older framework, like maybe like AngularJS. Now, if you like AngularJS, you can still continue creating front-end application in that, of course, but I think it's easier to find developers that can actually, that will be able to take that AngularJS and then add more features and maintain that than it would be, for instance, with C++. There's not that many people anymore that knows C++ that would be able to actually take that code and maintain it. So I think you're right about that, yes.
You know, in fact, C++ is very interesting because it's a compilable language. You can't believe through C++ you can solve a lot of problems at compilation time. Can you believe you can do mathematics in compilation time? You can, a lot of mathematics things. It's really hard to believe. Java has something like this feature.
If Java has math features, the problem.
No. Can you do mathematics in Java language in compilation time? I don't mean at runtime. I mean at compilation time.
That is a good question because the compiler is getting smarter and smarter. But I don't think so. No, it will do it runtime. It will do it runtime, and it actually sucks at it because especially if you're using doubles, like if you're using the default double. Then you can just multiply 0.1 with 0.1, and you don't get a wrong result. You'll get 0.009999 something weird. So it's with math and Java, you really need to be careful, and you need to know which classes to use and which one not to use. There are so many mistakes with people that use doubles out there, and then they cannot make their budget or their accounting sum up in the end. Not at compile time. It will actually run the code at runtime.
Yes, to be honest, people usually don't like C++ languages because they think it's very hard to learn. But they have to use that. Suppose NASA have to use the C++ language. They don't have any option. in defense domains, in aerospace domains, in telecommunications, and I think maybe in also in backend section, sometimes developers have to use C++ because it's really reliable. I think all of those systems which really needs high performance, which really needs low latency, they have to use C++. Do you agree with me? You're a Java developer, and I think Java is also used in high performance and low latency systems. Am I right?
Yes, the problem is also like with train systems, the signaling systems for trains, they are most often written in just C, not even C++, just C, because they don't want the Java garbage collector suddenly to come and take up all the performance to garbage collect. So they also see it as much stable. So yes, sending rockets out in space is probably in C++, and Java. But the garbage collector, you can actually turn off the garbage collector. So it's not possible to write it in Java.
And one interesting thing I heard of about Java, it was about it has a lot of rich libraries in trading. I heard of Java is really used compulsively in trading system. I mean those system which Bloomberg produced them. It's very interesting. You know, Java is really a great language and tools for internet and internet systems, and I think those high performance internet systems.
Yes.
Java has some versions. I just heard of that, like SE, EE. What's the difference between these versions?
And there are different. Right now, Oracle has one version, and they have placed a small license file, and people don't like that license that they have placed inside the Java SDK. So there's actually a lot of other. There's OpenJDK and there's Oracle JDK, and the difference is that the OpenJDK is not bound by the license terms that Oracle is binding the developer with. And the problem is that actually that is unclear what the license actually means. That's what the developers don't like. But regarding Java, when you start it up, there's some overhead by running Java. It will eat up some more memory than if you have a small C or C++ program. But it's also more scalable. It scales. I think it can scale better. But that's my feeling. While the, of course, the C++ and C, you have more control over memory management and stuff like that, which is not handled by Java. Java is made for writing business rules and writing things that need to be done, and then you should not think about how to fill up the memory, for instance. And then C and C++, they're a bit more, you micromanage your memory a bit more, and you can set some pointers and stuff like that. But Java, of course, you have references, but it's taken care of for you. So it's more like a business language, I would say. So.
And you know, I saw Java has also some implementation. No, I just heard of about OpenJDK and Oracle implementation. And always, I think those library like OpenJDK, I think those libraries have some sort of disparity. I don't know. Am I right?
I don't think so. I'm always using OpenJDK and sometimes the Zulu distribution when I can. So
What's the difference between Oracle implementation and OpenJDK? Because I'm not a Java developer. I really want to know that.
It is the license that is the main difference is that the license has been taken out of the OpenJDK and the there's also, I think there's some, I'm actually not sure if there's any longer and some classes that is that is a part of the Oracle JDK. In old days, they actually still had some classes that they chose to put in there. But it is mainly the license that is paid that has been taken out, and then it has been bundled again. So or else it actually runs just like it's maintained by the community, the OpenJDK, while the Oracle JDK is maintained by Oracle. But as soon as Oracle put something in a new Java version, then OpenJDK comes with the same feature afterwards. So they can do the same things, but our OpenJDK is just without the license limitations that the Oracle likes to put into it. That's my interpretation. That's the problem. If you talk to an Oracle sales guy, then he will probably say there's a lot of other benefits by using Oracle. But I always use OpenJDK. Because then I don't get into it and licensing trouble. So
yes, okay, we are coming to the end of this video podcast. It was really, really nice to meet you. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you for having me here, Reza. So thank you.
Thanks to you for joining us, and that was a really great conversation. And have a nice day.
Yes, thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye bye. Bye.